Yes, it is fucking weird.
I appreciate you guys coming out. Like I said, it's the first time we've ever done anything like this at Cafe Colonial, and I hope it's not the last. Before I bring out our panel for the evening, I just wanted to paint a little picture for you. The first question that I'm going to ask our panel members is to tell me about their first experience at an independent wrestling show. Now, that's the only question that I gave them. I said, I've only got a few questions that I've written out. I kind of wanted to deal with it the same way I would deal with a wrestling match. You don't want to can out every single fucking move that you do. You know, you want it to be organic. You want to be able to feed off of the energy of that person that you're in there. You want to feed off the audience. And so that's the kind of vibe that I want to have with this. So I've only got a few questions to kind of, that are written down that I'm going to kind of use as an outline. But then we're going to just let the discussion go where it may. But before I bring them out, the first question I'm going to ask them is to describe their first pro wrestling independent show experience. And so I wanted to give you mine before I bring them out. So imagine, if you will, it's 1978. I was 8 years old, so do the math. My cousin took me to what is now known as the Fox 40 Studios, but back then it was known as the KTXL TV 40 Studios, right around the corner here on Fruit Ridge Road. For those of you about the same age as I am, as the home of Captain Mitch and reruns of Gilligan's Island, but most importantly, that was also the home to Big Time Wrestling, not to be confused with the promotion out of the Bay Area that runs every blue moon. Big Time Wrestling was a promotional show to help promote in the Roy Shire territory, and they would promote shows that would happen at the Stockton Civic Center, at the Cow Palace, and more importantly, the Memorial Auditorium. So I'm about 8 years old. I've seen wrestling, I love wrestling, but I've never been to a live wrestling event. My cousin's taking me to this. It's this hot, hot little TV studio, and it's really sweaty and muggy, and there's only about 40 people who are sitting on one side of the ring. There's the ring, there's the, everyone crammed on the other side, and then the TV cameras and all that. And I'd never been to a wrestling show, but I do remember that the crowd was loud and boisterous and just yelling the worst things possible. And I was, I was always told sit down, shut up. And so I just kind of bawled. I, believe it or not, for those of you who know me, I kept my mouth shut at a wrestling show, which was a big deal. And I didn't know what to do. I saw everyone yelling for people, cheering for people, and I kept quiet up until one very important match. And I forget who came out first, but everyone was cheering for them. It could have even been Tito Santana. It was a good-looking guy, came out, jumped into the ring, everyone's cheering for him. Still kept quiet. But then when his opponent came out, that's when I found my voice. And his opponent was Playboy Buddy Rose. And when Playboy Buddy Rose came out, there wasn't a single person in that studio audience who didn't have an opinion about him. And they screamed and they yelled at him. They yelled the worst things. And when Playboy Buddy Rose finally made his way in front of me, I finally found the courage to stand up and do what you're supposed to do in an independent wrestling show. I called him a big fatty head. He heard it. He looked at me and he said, "Shut up, kid." I didn't say a single word for the rest of the night. Fast forward decades later, I'm at a Cauliflower Alley convention where they're inducting Playboy Buddy Rose. They're honoring him. And I told him this story, and he apologized. He's like, "Oh, I'm so sorry." I'm like, "Dude, don't apologize. You taught me everything that I need to know about pro wrestling that night. And there wasn't a single time that I made my way to the ring that I didn't think of that impact that Playboy Buddy Rose had on me. And nothing made me feel better than when a promoter was telling me, "All right, we want you to be a heel." And I'd go out there and I'd find that kid and I'd tell him to shut up and they'd yell back at him. And it just kept bringing me back to that one very important moment in my life when Playboy Buddy Rose told me to shut up. And it was something magical, and it's something that unless you're at an independent wrestling show where you can have that kind of, where the wrestlers aren't wrestling to a camera, they're wrestling to the fans. You can't describe that. And that was my first experience with independent wrestling, and I'll never forget it, and it's a very important part of my life. So I want to hear what each of the panel members, what their very first experience was. So let's bring them out right now. So to start off, our first panel member, he wrestles as Alexis Derevko, and he is one of the powers to be at Action Coast Empire Wrestling. So please welcome Alexis. Come on out. He will not be singing the Russian national anthem. All right, believe it or not, our next guest, I was told, is one of the powers of pro wrestling Bushido. Drove all the way out here and just made it just in the nick of time. Please welcome Bobby Hart. Bobby Hart. How you doing, Bobby?
I'm good.
All right. Our next panel member, he has wrestled all over the world. He is one of the powers to be of one of the most highly attended and most popular promotions in Northern California right now, which is Hood Slam. So please welcome Sheik Khan Abadi to our panel. Oh, it's a good thing I've got one of these in my. All right, our next guest started off as a wrestling journalist in the days of Angel Fire and GeoCities, and then became a wrestling announcer for HWA, I think it was. Anyway, but now he's graduated to be one of the powers to be for Sacramento's very own Supreme Pro Wrestling. Please welcome Sir Samurai Josh Littell. Our next panel member, quite frankly, is the Madonna of Northern California wrestling, in my opinion, and I mean that as a compliment, because I don't think I've ever known an artist in the world of professional wrestling who has changed his look and changed his attire and just his character so many times and so successfully. And so tonight, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Doc Atrocity. He is the mayor of everything. And last but not least, he is affectionately known to many of us as Boss. Quite frankly, there aren't a whole lot of us that would be here doing what we do, and I definitely wouldn't have fallen deeper in love in wrestling because if it weren't for this man. And I can't thank him enough, and I can never repay him enough for the lessons he's not only taught me in that ring, but in turn in life, and the courage that he's instilled in me. One of my favorite people in the world, the Big Ugly, J.D. Bishop. Notice I didn't say anything about milkshakes. All right, but seriously, thank you, Virgil Flynn, for filling in for Bobby Hart. Obviously, Bobby Hart can't be here. Virgil was outside berating me because there's no black people on the panel.
We're gonna do it. Let's do it right.
He's an Eskimo. All right, so you guys. I said I was only going to talk for like 5 or 10 minutes. It was more like 20. But I talked about my first experience in independent wrestling. And that was the only question that I fed to most of the panel. Bobby knew about the question. And so what I'd like to know is, to get us started, what was your first experience in the independent wrestling, whether it was as a fan or as a worker? Let's start off Tarepko.
Mine was 1990, 91, something like that, and a friend of mine took me to a Paul Brown's WCWA show with Johnny Payne and Big Money, Bill Monroe. Mack Truck was like a 800-pound gigantic black man who didn't do anything but punch.
You heard that, Virgil. It was a black wrestler.
Yes.
Okay, so you represent.
And my one standout memory of it was Paul Brown breaking, I want to say, like, rail ties or something at intermission, and then Johnny Payne pulling a fan out of the audience and beating him up, and me being like, we're going to the show tomorrow, and that happened to some guy? Like, come on now. Years later, I find out who it was, and it's actually my good friend, Big Money. So, and he was just a young boy in the business at the time. So that was my first real impression of, and I'm friends with Johnny Payne as well, so it's kind of 20 years later, 25 years later.
All right, and Virgil, what was your first experience in independent wrestling?
My first experience actually was with Supreme Pro Wrestling. I had just started training, and there was a show downtown that everybody heard at somebody's school, I can't remember whose, but there were big signs of wrestlers outside in front of the school, and my friends had called me repeatedly, hey, you need to get downtown, there's a show downtown, you might want to be around and talk to these guys. Well, just so happened to pan out that when I got there, it was a show I wasn't there at, supposedly should be at, doing ring crew four, which was an SPW show, which turned out it was a good thing, because I got there and I wanted to see what was going on, it turned out it was an SPW show, which I was training at the time, but I wasn't there to do ring crew, and it turned out to be a really good experience. I got to see things from a different angle as a fan, like it was the show in which Adam and Luster played janitors, and in the crowd, and it was popcorn. They were wrestling for popcorn, and it was awesome because the kids ate it up, dude. It was the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. Like if you've never been around something like a wave movement, it's really a heartwarming experience when you can have 150 little kids going nuts over guys ramping and raving over popcorn.
So that was the same show that Choopy was almost mauled by a group of second grade girls.
Yes.
Okay, yeah. Back then he was wrestling as Hot Stuff Rudy Tootie.
Yes.
He was, and I was, it was my second grade class, and they nearly tore him limb from limb.
Yeah, those kids were, that was awesome, because those kids were absolutely crazy, and I had never seen that before, and I won't say I had a bad taste with wrestling at that time, but I had never seen indie wrestling catch eyes like that.
Yeah.
And when you see indie wrestling catch eyes like that, you're hooked, man. It was awesome.
And Sam, your first experience with independent wrestling?
Sure. First, I want to say I've known Chubby for 7 years. He's never brought up Hot Stuff Rudy Tootie.
Really, Hot Stuff Rudy Tootie was amazing. He had a kind of a model Rick Martel kind of a spray bottle, and he would spray it in the air and then jump into it.
Bring that back. And,
Hot Stuff Rudy Tootie was fantastic.
Who was the promoter that had him come out with the strippers that pretty much almost ended his relationship? Was that Rob? No, it was
Rob. Well, it definitely wasn't the school show that
there
we
was
did.
Nobody here, yeah, for sure.
All right, so back to your first experience with independent wrestling.
I brought a prop even. I don't know if it's exactly the first, but this is a Curry Man shirt, autographed.
I have that.
That I got maybe 99, 2000 at an APW show. And I waited probably an hour after the show, maybe 45 minutes to get this autographed. And he's like, how should I sign it, Christopher Daniels or Curry Man? I don't know. What do you think? It's called Jim Curry, man. That's a good idea.
Now, had you ever run into Christopher Daniels on independent shows after that?
Yes, many times.
Have you ever brought up the story?
No, never once. He's always playing DS in the locker room. He doesn't really care. But it was an APW show, and I remember Jardy France running off the wall and doing a backflip when someone threw him at the wall. And I thought it was the craziest thing I've ever seen. Until I saw him like a week ago, and he's younger than me now. But other than that, very memorable event. APW was on fire. They had the West Side Players. This is when Max Justice was still strong. Mm-hmm. Mike Modest and Donovan Morgan were how we remembered them. And things were very entertaining. Things were great. That was My first indie show.
Okay, and Josh, your first indie show.
I want to say it was NCW, mm-hmm. right? They used to run the memorial.
Yeah.
I lived in Chico at the time, and I got a flyer, and I couldn't find anyone willing to go to Sacramento, so I came by myself, mm-hmm. sat in the first row, and during intermission, they did the gimmick where you can get pictures taken. And I
yeah.
got pictures with Jake the Snake Roberts and Sabu. And okay. I was still very much a mark. The camera jammed, and Sabu looks at me, and his Detroit accent says, "Bro, you're so ugly, you just broke the fucking camera." And it broke my heart, because I didn't think he spoke English. Right? Sabu never spoke, and he would have watched wrestling. It just changed how I viewed everything.
What a fan, what a fan. You didn't care that he insulted, you were just like,
"Oh, no,
he spoke, oh my God."
I have a mirror. I mean, it's, I know what I look like. But yeah, that was, I don't remember a single match, but I remember him and Jake the Snake,
I remember
Honky it. Tonk, and Greg
yeah,
the Hammer.
Yeah, T.C. Martin, T.C. Martin, I remember yeah. that. The one of the biggest disappointments about NWC for me was I was at one of the shows and he was out there and I asked him, like, "Hey, what can I do to help and get involved?" You know, and I offered, you know, street team, anything, I'll set up the ring, I'll clean, and his response was, "I'll just keep coming to the shows," and just kind of brushed me off that yeah. way. So much more heartbreaking than hearing Sabu speak with his Detroit accent. But anyway. All right, and Doc, your first experience in independent wrestling.
I'm going to age myself here, but to be honest with you, there really was no such term as independent wrestling when I got into the business. I mean, there were small time shows that guys like Jerry Monty ran, and you know, T.C. Martin and stuff like that, but mm-hmm. it wasn't really indie wrestling at that point. Me and some other guys that I grew up with did. You know, what is now backyard wrestling, but back then, you know, that wasn't a term either. That wasn't yeah. really, you know, this is pre-internet and everything. And two of the guys that I trained with ended up, we did a bunch of backyard stuff. We actually worked with a guy who trained us, who trained with Woody Farmer from Bay Area Wrestling.
Wow.
Who actually
okay.
had a cable show in the Bay Area, short-lived cable show. Trained with him, kind of beat us up for a couple of months. We put on some shows, and my first real, like, actual show was in San Francisco, California. I saw a flyer for it didn't even have a promotion name yet. It was like Freaky Rockabilly Wrestling, and I was like, sold. I'm totally going to this. And I was standing in line with Bill and Chris Cole, who were training at APW at the time.
Okay.
And we're standing in line to get in. And Johnny Legend, who was promoting these shows at the time, eventually what became Incredibly Strange Wrestling, was running down the aisle and saw Bill and Chris, who I was standing with, and was like, "Oh my God." He knew them because they had actually done an ISW show, Rockabilly Wrestling at the time. In the past, he was like, "I need workers. Some of my guys didn't show up." And Bill was like, "Well, I didn't bring any gear." And I was like, "I can't wait. Like, I'll do it." You know, I was like, "I'll do it." So my first actual show that I went to go and be in the audience to actually ended up wrestling as one of Johnny Legend's many extremely creative characters. I was one half of a tag team known as Satan's Centipedes. And we did a job. We did a job for a team that was the late Stephen De Leon, who wrestled as Anarchy. He was the lead singer for a kind of quintessential LA punk rock band called Foreign Object. They had a kind of pro wrestling edge to them. And another wrestler by the name of Fisico Nuclear, I think. And it was amazing. I got this amazing thrill of going from standing in line to get into the show to, next thing I know, I'm throwing on some commercial level lucha mask mm-hmm. and a way too tight singlet, and went out there and performed, and it was I was totally hooked from there on out.
All right. And we're definitely going to be bringing up Incredibly Strange Wrestling in a bit. Gabe, your first experience with independent wrestling. Ugly.
Yeah. My first one was actually at Woody Farmer's in Bay Area Wrestling.
Okay.
I remember I contacted him because when I was in high school, I used to watch it on the during football season. We get a, you know, double days we do our Halloween. We get to go home for a little bit. I'd watch Bay Area Wrestling and seen the commercial for the school. So I finally went down there, and he's like, "Yeah, we're doing the show this weekend coming up, and you can help out." So I did ring crew and everything, and like really wasn't impressed. Like I was watching like the Spanish Hitman and
About what year was it? About what year was it?
1991. Okay. The year I graduated, not to date myself, but I remember watching this fucking one gimmick, and he must have been 65 years old, and he run around and he was hitting people with the fucking cowbell. And when I first started doing shows, I fucking seen him again. So he must have been 85. So I remember like 4 months ago, I seen him again, and fucking Shane Cody must be a billion years fucking old. Still fucking hitting people with the fucking belt, and he has a belt that his dad bought like in the 40s, and he's still the fucking champion. Because nobody takes it from him. But after doing the ring and all that shit, I was like, yeah, I can do this, it's no problem. And then they shut down. I went to see Buzz Sawyer School here in SAC for a while. Mm-hmm. He shut down. And then I went to DeMarco School in APW the same weekend.
Yeah.
And watching
that. That's Paul DeMarco, Pro AM.
When I went to DeMarco School, it was like a bunch of guys in the ring just falling around. Mm-hmm. And I went to APW, like Mike Modest was in the ring training people. So I decided to go to APW, a lot more money. It was a lot harder. But it was the kind of quality of training that I wanted.
Yeah.
I didn't want the bullshit to happen after, but it was just, I really liked the fact that Modest was in the ring training people. It wasn't just a bunch of guys fucking around grabbing each other.
Yeah.
It was actually, guys were working, and it's where I really learned about the business, the wrestling, the bad side and the good side.
Yeah.
That was my first introduction to independent wrestling.
And sometimes seeing I think everyone on the panel would agree, sometimes seeing the negative side is as much a learning experience.
Well, the thing though is, because you're so fucking blind and you're still drinking the Kool-Aid, you don't see it as negative.
Yeah.
You don't see driving 9 hours to set up a fucking ring, be everybody's bitch, make no money, go home, fucking set the ring back up at the school, and nobody even say fucking thank you, and then you come in and you're the bump bitch for the night.
Yeah.
As anything wrong with it.
Yeah.
You know, you don't see a fat guy like Vinny Mazzaro telling you a piece of shit. When you can't even see the fucking bottom top of his shoes, because he's a fucking guy. You know, he's my best friend now, but you think you're bought into it. This is the business, this is the way the business, this is just what you have to do, and it's really not, but you want to get into the business, you believe everything the fucking bitches tell you.
Yeah.
That's, you don't realize it's bad at the time, you just realize that that's the way wrestling is.
Yeah, well, Ugly and Doc, you're the two people who I want to direct this next question to. The topic today is the state of NorCal pro wrestling, you know, where we are right now. But let's talk about that mid to late 90s. When I started getting involved with wrestling, I actually, a lot of people think that, well, you know, yeah, you know, you got involved with SPW and Big Ugly, but Big Ugly and SPW is actually my second experience with independent wrestling. My first experience was actually with Doc over at Incredibly Strange Wrestling in San Francisco. So I want to pick your guys' brain. If you could describe what the scene was like in Northern California in the mid to late 90s, and don't hold anything back, because now, and I talked to a few people about this, now when we say Roland Alexander, there's like genuinely a moment of silence and the Godfather, because the mark that he left was a beautiful one and a very positive one, and one where he really brought the scene together. But that was a different story back then. You know, Roland Alexander and, you know, APW and their relationship with ISW, their relationship with SPW and RPW and NEW, completely different. So if I could pick your guys' brain, how would you describe what the scene was like back then? Doc, we'll start with you.
Roland Alexander was a fucking carny prick back then. In all honesty, he made his money by getting guys into his school, breaking their spirit, and getting them to quit, but still collecting on his fee.
Mm-hmm.
He was adamant about that. By hook or by crook, he was going to get his money. And then the guys that toughed it out, that put up with the bullshit that Ugly was talking about, and ate all the crap sandwiches, mm-hmm. and did exactly what they were told, would eventually get, you know, they would be allowed into the inner sanctum of Roland Alexander and mm-hmm. APW. And he really had, at that point, he really had a stranglehold on indie wrestling.
Yeah.
He was a genius at marketing his school as, I'm the shit and everybody else is kind of untrained backyard garbage.
Yeah.
And He convinced a lot of people, not only in APW, but outside APW, that fact. And he was very adamant about not letting his guys work other places if he thought it wouldn't benefit him. Mm-hmm. He looked down on Incredibly Strange Wrestling because he thought it was a clown show. He said, it's not real wrestling. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, we're outdrawing you, so...
Yeah, and that's one thing I've always been interested, because you were in Incredibly Strange Wrestling, and I joke about this, but I'm not really joking about it when I say I was the technical high flyer, because I knew how to do a mahi stroll and I had a second rope plancha that couldn't be beat. You know, but you were the trained wrestler that whenever they brought someone in, I remember doing an ISW show where you wrestled Tyson Tomko, because you were the only one who could handle it. So how were you able to go back and forth between ISW and APW?
Well, I never actually trained with APW. I hung around with APW, and I came to practices, and I got in the ring when nobody was looking, but I never gave Roland Alexander a dime of money.
Wow.
I came and I hung out, because my friends were all training there, and he tolerated me, because I would throw ideas out there, and I guess he saw something in me. When Roland teamed up with Manny Fernandez, when Manny Fernandez first came to Northern California, Manny Fernandez was actually like, I had green hair at the time, and I was bigger than a lot of the guys that mm-hmm. were training.
Yeah.
And he said, we gotta do something with this guy. And he was like, can you talk? And I was like, yeah, I can talk. I can bump, I can talk. You know, they won't put me in a match, but I can do all the other stuff. And he made me a manager. And I was actually, for a good 5-year run in APW, I was the top heel manager in the company.
Absolutely, absolutely.
With Max Justice and a variety of other wrestlers. But because I was kind of, as Roland always told me, a peripheral character, a window dressing character, I wasn't one of the superstars, and I was never going to be as far as he was concerned,
mm-hmm.
I had this kind of ability to go to ISW, which I personally loved. I found it incredibly entertaining, groundbreaking, completely different. I've always agreed that, you know, that the guys that were working there weren't trained, they were pretty yeah. miserable in the ring, but I loved what they were doing. I wanted to be part of it.
But we thought we were great.
I got a lot of heat actually yeah. for openly saying you guys are kind of untrained.
Yeah.
You know, you're kind of a mess out there. Mm-hmm. And even in Count Dante's book, he quotes me running down the talent at Incredibly Strange mm-hmm. Wrestling while I'm working there.
Yeah.
And I stand by that, you know. But I remember one time Michael Modest, backstage at an APW show, him and Donovan Morgan were really good friends. And they were kind of top dogs and kind of ribbing me, kind of giving me a hard time. They called me the Terry Funk of Incredibly Strange Wrestling, because I've been around for so long. I'd been all over the place, and I was like their top guy.
Yeah.
And they meant it in a kind of condescending fashion, but I always took that as an absolute, I mean, that's the nicest compliment you could give me, relating me to Terry Funk in any way, shape, or form.
Yeah.
Even especially with Incredibly Strange Wrestling, who I worked with for 11 years, you know, from early in the beginning of, not quite the beginning of that promotion, but early on until the day it stopped running, I worked for that company.
Yeah.
And I took a lot of pride in that. I got a lot of heat. A lot of the guys gave me a hard time, but I traveled the country with Incredibly Strange Wrestling, going on the Vans Warped Tour for yeah. 2 or 3 months, and I traveled all of Europe when we were on the Deconstruction Tour with NoFX.
Yeah.
So I got this opportunity to travel around the world wrestling for a company that at the time was drawing upwards of thousands of people.
We were selling out
the Fillmore. We were selling out the Fillmore in San Francisco, and I was getting heat from indie wrestling guys who were making $20 a night and sleeping in a loft above the warehouse where they trained guys were giving me a hard time because I was performing in front of thousands of people all around the world, but it wasn't wrestling. And I kind of never got over that. You know, I think Hood Slam to a particular extent is a redemption.
Yeah. Now, Ugly, let's talk about from your side of the thing, your side of where what indie wrestling was like, because you were kind of blackballed from APW. You went to train at North American Wrestling, and there were three promotions that worked very closely together. There was Supreme Pro Wrestling here in Sacramento, RPW, Revolutionary Pro Wrestling, based in Stockton, and North American Wrestling, based in Fresno. And oddly enough, back then, North American Wrestling was, within R3, they were the cream of the crop. You had You had Brian Ward. You had the Big Ugly. You had back then this guy by the name of Dante. He had Professor Poindexter, Mike Matrix, Bulldog, Brian Raymond. All the top wrestlers in our circle were from North American wrestling. Now, but let's talk about, how would you describe the scene back then? You know, we had Shane with ISW and APW, and then you're down here with SPW, RPW, and NAW.
Well, basically back then, you know, Roland kind of had a monopoly on business. And I mean, if anybody knows me and Roland's history, we don't really have a lot of good things to say about each other except for the last year or so. But what Roland did is what any major corporation does. You don't see Coke out and Pepsi. You know, you don't see other products out of products. Their product's the only one that matters. And that's basically what he did. It's a smart business move. So when I came down here to wrestle for Supreme Pro Wrestling, which is kind of a backyard company at the time, he had a couple of his guys, Vinny Massaro, I think Voice of Bronze, Yardy France, and a couple of the guys were on the show, and Roland basically told him, if Gabe's on that show, I'm pulling my guys. So Rich Roby, the original owner of SPW, said, hey, don't worry, bro, just next show I'll bring you in, I just can't afford to lose these guys. Stuck to his word, he got rid of APW and brought me in. And I think in the second show, he asked me to be the booker. And I told him, fuck, I don't know how to book. I don't know none of this. I've been in the business 6 months, you know? And I said, but I'm not gonna rip you off, and I'm gonna make sure your shows are as entertaining as they can be. So basically the formula I used was, everything Roland wasn't doing, I was gonna do it. In part just to piss him off, but in part just because I didn't feel that you had to treat people like shit to have a successful company. So, I mean, and then I say this, but the first show I booked, I fired like 10 people, and they were like the main guys, because they either came out in like, you know, wife beater shirts and jeans, or just showed up in the shit they were going to wrestle in, and they just were just big guys, never been trained or nothing. So I basically fired all these guys who were supposedly waiting in the parking lot for me, and that was fine. And I hired a bunch of kids who I was training, and then through that I started hiring other people who people weren't using, kids who were hungry, kids who wanted it. And then throughout the years, we became like the bastard child of every company, because we would take in guys who people wouldn't use. There was a guy named, at the time, it was called Backstage Cancer, Adam Thornstow. Nobody wanted to work with Adam. Adam was fucking phenomenal. I took, brought him in and made him my fucking champion, because it pissed people off. There was other guys out there. I brought in the twins. I ran all the Brawl guys. I would just bring in other guys who I knew who could work and I could trust. I knew that if shit went down, they were going to be the first ones having my back. So I just went the whole other way, and I just wanted to get people who I can trust and who can work, who work their ass off for a company. So we actually branched off in, with NAW, where I finished my training, and then RPW stopped and started, and then Brawl started doing their thing, and then I think Bobby started doing Bushido. All these companies kind of started forming together, and kind of made this circuit of family, you know. And it wasn't like that before. You either worked for here or you didn't fucking work.
Yeah.
Or you had to talk to this promoter to hire his guys. And the mentality I try to get people is, you know, if somebody's telling you can't work there, his name better be Vince McMahon. Because no fucking independent promoter is paying you to not wrestle somewhere. None of us went through all this fucking months and years of training to work for one fucking company, unless it's Japan or fucking WWE. So I tell all my guys, hey, if you have a better booking, because my payouts are shitty, go fucking do that shit. I don't care. If someone's going to pay you $100 to wrestle, fucking go.
Yeah.
I'll fix my shit.
And I think that was the point that you guys definitely made, is there wasn't a lot of harmony in NorCal. I mean, I remember when we were training in Stockton, and then when we moved the training right next door to the theater, I remember walking to my car, and all of our cars were keyed with the initials of a promotion up in Yuba City.
Yeah.
And there wasn't harmony. And I remember going to work for certain promotions and having to bring someone with me because there wasn't that harmony there. And there definitely, it is a different scene. And so...
Back then it was just a bunch of people hating.
Yeah.
And the kind of the philosophy I used was, you know, if, let's just say APW, for example, if they're that great, if they're the top thing and they're the greatest thing ever, and they're taking time out of their busy day to bash me, I must be something pretty fucking special.
Yeah.
Like, I must have something special here if the elite company is taking time out of their busy schedule to be number one to fuck with us. So I just left it alone. I even told my guys, fucking don't worry about it. And within, I think, 2 years, I had students that were the champion over there, Kryptonite, who never finished his fucking training with me, was the fucking internet champion over there or something.
Yeah. And by all means, I don't mean to besmirch the name or legacy of Roland Alexander, but I think it adds to the beauty of how his life turned around and how he changed from what I remember my first experience of Roland Alexander and what APW represented to me when I started, and then what the legacy that he left and how he left as the most beloved person.
Well, what people don't realize, like with Roland, is because a lot of us have been exposed to different types of promoters who haven't gone that way. Roland was a fucking independent wrestling promoter.
Yes.
That's what they fucking all did.
Yeah.
Fucking the Hearts, fucking all those guys, that's what they do. They fucking shit on people to make their product better because that's how they make their money.
Yeah.
And we were one of the ones that we wanted to work together. We just wanted to, we were fucking nobodies. We're the bastard children of fucking independent wrestling. So we didn't have time to shit on people to make ourselves look good. But that's what independent wrestling were. It's cutthroat. Back then, it's still some of the companies you go to now. It's fucking cutthroat. You could never get owners of companies sitting here fucking bullshitting.
Yeah.
There's no way you'd get fucking T.C. Martin and fucking Don Owen and fucking all these guys sitting here talking, about wrestling.
In part, when I was being interviewed by Capital Public Radio, and I said, the fact that I can get these guys to sit in a room, that's a bit of an accomplishment. And I mean, it's definitely not the same scene as it was back then, but to bring it to everyone else now, and take a second to think about this. And those of you, the audience is comprised of a majority of you are wrestlers. I've got wrestlers out there, I've got promoters out there, I've got the most diehard fans out there. So everyone think about this, and then we'll listen to their question. In one word, how would you describe the current state of NorCal wrestling? Now, I want you guys to think about this. I'm going to write down the word that you come up with, and we're going to talk about that. So, and I'd like everyone else to think about one word, and if you need to make it a hyphenated word, that's fine. And if you can't keep it to one word, try and keep it to one sentence. But I'd really like it if, in one word, if you could describe the current state of NorCal wrestling. And Derevko, we'll start with you.
Okay, I'm not going to give you one word, so. Honestly, it's very crowded. It's going to be my crowded is the word.
Virgil.
Red.
Red.
R-E-D, red.
R-E.
Yeah,
sorry,
I'm
very red.
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 Okay.
Red.
Blue. How would you, what's one word you would use?
Oh, he's got one word.
Okay,
that was his word.
No, I'm gonna give it a
redo.
What's one word that you would use?
Blooming. Blooming.
Samurai.
Hungry.
Hungry.
Hunger.
Hungry!
There you go, hungry. Okay.
Come on.
Hungry.
Doc. Potential.
Ugly.
Not to dwell on the color thing, but I'd say green. Not in a bad way.
So now you're saying not in a bad way. It's interesting. I'm going to ask you to explain yours because I don't know if that's a positive or negative.
Okay.
The black guy has to explain. No. And it's because you're black.
Yeah.
I know we're in Oak Park, but this is my neighborhood. Because I pick up and I'm glad you said not in a negative way. Then I'm picking up a lot of positivity, but I think we need to be realistic that there is some negativity. So I'm going to ask you to explain, first off, red. Why?
Well, if you think about it, this is just my honest opinion. I think NorCal has kind of been running in the red. And the show of that is how many wrestlers now are owners paying out of their own pocket to put on shows.
Hmm.
it's obvious. Like, you have everybody up here.
So yours is definitely a negative
connotation. Well, it's not negative. It just shows how many different people are willing to go out there and create because they feel like these guys here are the best in the world.
So in one, it's a double-edged sword. In one way, it's positive because you got these people who are willing to say, you know what? I'm gonna lose my ass because I love this.
I'm not gonna.
But on the other side, it's a shame that someone who loves it so much is gonna lose their ass, and they're not even gonna make their money back for the most part.
Well, everybody, I can say everybody on this panel probably has walked up to me and paid me out of their pocket, out of their own wallet, and not bought me a meal. First PL right there, bought me a McRib. You know, but everybody here has gone through that, and then they said to themselves, "I know these guys are worth it." Mm-hmm. I know in the back of my mind, if I put these guys out here, if I take an Adam Thornstow and throw him at the wall hard enough, everybody's going to pick up on him. If I take a Chupacabra and throw him at the hard wall hard enough, he's going to stick. You know what I mean? And that's what NorCal is. NorCal is some of the best guys in the world that haven't been touched. Because not that it's red, but we're red hot. As you go to any show, you have a plethora of guys that are better than any WWE guy you can put out there, you know, myself included.
I've always felt like the East Coast and Southern California gets the spotlight, and from early on, I've always thought there's guys performing in that theater, there's guys performing in this hall that can blow away and the East Coast and Southern California.
Myself personally, I've had to learn this. I learned this with this guy right here living in Florida. We drove from Florida all the way up to Louisville, Kentucky to do a show in OVW in which half the guys there weren't as good as us with me and with my blown shoulder. And we're, you know, at the time, young bucks in the business. Yeah. But I didn't know that. And then getting back and being able to see it, it made me want to stand behind it even more. Yeah. Because once you see what's out there, they're not that good. You know, and I've done camps with Harley and all this stuff. I'm not trying to toot my own horn, but when you see the rest of the world, and then you see what you have here, like, you would understand why a guy would pay out of his own pocket.
Yeah.
His hard-earned paycheck, whether he was a guy like Benny Massaro who worked at Terminex or whatever and he was running a company like CCW, or was my trainer who was just like, hey, I need you, or if it was that guy who was like, hey, I'm kind of sidearm booking at a show, or if it was this guy like, hey, I got a spot for you, or if it was this guy who was like, hey, you want a spot. But these guys would come out of their pocket, and running in the red, not having a problem with it. Shows don't draw, we're talking. But, I mean, you had guys drawing 30 people, 40 people for long periods of time because there was multiple companies trying to prosper. You had SPW, you had NAW, you know, you had Brawl coming up. And it was cool because I got to get work and I got to hone my craft, but these guys were running in the red. Guys were pulling their money together to buy rings. They were pulling their money together to buy insurance. You know what I mean? That's what was going on. Guys were running in the red. Yeah. And they kind of still are, but it's a beautiful thing because you know these guys have faith in you.
We wouldn't have gotten that out of Bobby.
All right, now
Derebko and Sheik, I want the two of you to play off each other because it's important that we see that negative connotation and that positive connotation with a very similar. You have crowded and you have blooming. So let's talk to the two of you right now. Now, how would you say it's blooming?
Kind of to bounce off what they already said, what you were just talking about with them, there was a time, and I think APW and SPW were doing really well, but that was pretty much the beginning of the end for NorCal, and I think we turned to a graveyard for about 3 or 4 years. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of wrestlers that stuck it out and busted their ass, and they're the ones that are still here today, and they're the ones that trained the new class, and everyone else that sucked and fucked off and were just in there for their own egos left because there was nothing for their own egos to feed off of in NorCal because we were a fucking graveyard, and now we're not. Now I see... Shit, we were talking about all these people emailing us last week. And a lot of people from a lot of companies are starting to say, hey, I want to come to the Bay Area, or I want to come to California. When before it was, I want to go to PWG and nothing else. Now they want to come to California. They want to come to Hood Slam or APW or whatever company. SWF is doing stuff with New Japan. I mean, that's mind-blowing. That's nothing that we... In 2007, if you told me that, I'd have laughed you out of the building. And followed you home. But now it's blooming. And what we have is there's... It's still, like you said, kind of crowded, but there's a lot of people that gave a fuck and stuck around when it sucked, and they knew it sucked, they dealt with it in the red. Like, I don't care, I know this is good, and I'm going to stick with it because it'll turn around. And I think we're in that, you know, it's the darkest hours before the dawn.
Yeah.
And I think we just came out of the dawn, and now we're in the sunrise, now we're blooming. Winter's over, springtime is coming, and we have a bright future ahead of us.
And I think that was definitely a point that we hit on earlier, that it was very dark. It was very dark. And now, in your opinion, we're starting to see the sunrise. Now, Derebko, explain what you mean by crowded.
For me, what I mean is you have all these companies and they use, you know, NorCal is very divided. Mm-hmm. There's three or four companies that use these 20 guys, and there's three or four companies that use these 20 guys. But they have 900 champions. They book Doc and Big Ugly 90 times in a row for the same three heavyweight titles.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't you just have one champion in that? You know, like my example, just looking at Samurai. Reno, Sacramento, Modesto.
Mm-hmm.
Why are they not all running the same storyline?
So we're talking about Reno Wrestling Factory, Supreme Pro Wrestling, and Pro Wrestling Bushido.
Thanks, I was drawing a blank on the names.
Yeah, that's okay.
And why is that not, that's their run? I mean, that's three shows a month, four shows a month, you know, if somebody runs twice. That's a good run, and then the guys can go out and work somewhere else. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, like with me, like we took Devil Mountain and Battleground from LA, and we've made it the Action Coast Empire. You know, our guys go to NorCal and SoCal. Half my shows are SoCal guys.
Mm-hmm.
Which I'm fine with, nobody else books them, so it's a great attraction for me, being mm-hmm. selfish. But at the same time, you then have companies, it seems like every time I go on Facebook, there's the new pro wrestling company, you know, somewhere. And it's like,
mm-hmm.
where is this? I don't even know. It's, to me, it seems like we're... It's in terms of wrestling companies,
mm-hmm.
we're becoming LA. There's like, I think we tried to
count. Who suffers from that though?
We do.
You think the workers or the fans suffer?
Because here's the thing. Honestly, when I say we, I mean everybody. Because if I'm using a storyline with me and Doug Ugly, and I plan, oh, me and Ugly are gonna do fucking something stupid with ladders or something. I guarantee you, the minute I announce it, another company is either going to do it the night before, or they're going to try to book us in some kind of match that's similar. And it's like, why would you do that? Why not go, I'm going to wait till they're done with their angle, and then book it?
So then are you saying that wrestlers should have promotion, be promotion exclusive, or?
No, what I'm saying is at some point, if we're all friends,
yeah.
Why are you not calling me? Why, if Gabe's running a show, or Ugly, I'm sorry, running a show, and, hey, I'm going to do this with you know, Samurai and Doc,
mm-hmm.
and I say, ah, shit, I was going to do something similar,
mm-hmm.
one of us should just be the better man or the better promoter and say, okay, I'll wait 6 months.
Yeah. Well, as a musician, that's something I can relate to because... I mean, you can see a punk rock show every night in Sacramento, and there are a few musicians who also book and who we talk to each other, and we'll definitely, for those of you who are familiar with any local musicians, like Sean Hills from the band Bastards of Young, he runs a promotion called Punch and Pie Fest, or Punch and Pie Productions, and puts on huge shows, and I put on shows, and we keep in talking with one another, hey, which bands are you working with? But it's a rare thing, and I mean I think and you're being realistic in that it's not easy to just say, hey, why don't we just have you know, Samurai and Sheik and you and them, and we all just sit down and we just plan out the next 6 months. I mean, that sounds easy, but it's not.
But is it not easy? Is it not? We're all sitting here right now. Why couldn't we do this?
Well, I'd like to think that something like an event like tonight is that step forward. Is that because like what I in order to encourage discussion.
And I agree. I mean, anyone who knows me, I've talked about trying to combine companies for a very long time. Yeah. You know, I know Sheik and I've had many conversations, especially.
But I don't know. But maybe, and this is just my opinion. I don't know about combining companies or just coordinating with companies.
Coordinating is probably the better terms.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's if Virgil's chasing the light heavyweight title at a company,
mm-hmm.
why wouldn't we just say, well, that light heavyweight title gets defended here, 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 and here
mm-hmm.
for 6 months, and then it goes to these eight promotions or four mm-hmm. promotions or whatever, and that would give them a chance to see Virgil Flynn
yeah.
throughout a whole year in 8 or 10 towns, yeah. whatever, and two or three times a month.
Yeah, we see how well that worked for NWA. All right, so let's move on. Let's talk about hungry and potential. Now, Samurai, you said hungry, and Doc, you said potential. Can you go into a little bit of explanation of that?
It's
still say I don't need a microphone.
When I was coming up, you know, I loved the wrestling, but I'd look around and after every match, 99% of the guys, no matter how bad the match was, everyone thought it was the greatest match ever. The show was the greatest show ever. They were the greatest wrestler ever. And that was what I saw for many years. And now when I look around NorCal, I see people who I look at, Adam Thornstone, Timothy Thatcher, Virgil Flynn, Chupacabra, who I'm like, that match was amazing, or CJ Curse is my favorite example of that. And he's pissed off after a match because it should have been better. It should have been better. So now that people are so much better, like the standards in 2014 for every company is so much higher than they were in 2007. But in 2007, people were happy with their mediocrity. And in 2014, excellence is not happy being excellent. And that fires me up because I know that nobody seems satisfied. And that's what caused you to work out harder, to go places you wouldn't go, to try things you haven't tried. And I think that's what leads to a healthier wrestling scene. Because status quo, I always say, if you're content with where you are, you're going to get worse. Whether it's your body or your skill set or your draw. If you're like, we've drawn enough, we don't need to worry about drawing anymore, well, your draw is going to go down. You have to stay hungry to keep going. And everyone in NorCal, it'll hit a home run and still be like, God damn it, that match was not what it should have been. And I find that very inspiring.
Now, Doc, you say potential, but in a way you can kind of see it as a negative as well as a positive. Can you explain what you mean by potential?
Well, that's my perspective when I look at Northern California independent wrestling right now. I'm the kind of guy when I look at wrestlers' talent in this business, I kind of look at them and I'm like, I see them as blocks of clay. I see them as blocks of clay that, ooh, if I put this guy in the right position with the right character, the right mindset, he could be something incredible. It's very rare that I look at a worker, you know, in Northern California, I'm like, ah, he's got it all, he's good to go. That guy's going to be in the big show. I see guys that are really, really close, and then I see guys that are nowhere near there, you know. But I look at them and I'm like, oh, you know, we tweak this, we put this on then, make this look, reference this, and, you know, you take something that is essentially potential energy, and you turn it into kinetic energy. You give it the right tools to develop itself, because ultimately that's what talent has to do. All these guys are trainers at some level or another, and all of them have worked with talent where you're like, you can give them all the tools in the world, you can teach them how to go out there and do the moves, and have the proper mentality, but there gets a particular point where, you have to take it to the next level, you know. And we have an obligation to lead them down that path. We're obligated to go, hey, why don't you try this? That's not working. Why don't you try this? That's really working. Keep doing that.
Okay.
And so when I see the talent in Northern California right now, and like the Revco said, it is crowded. There's a lot of talent out there right now. But that's a good thing in my mind. Because I see all these, what I see is this big bin of Legos. And I can take all these Legos and I can build a spaceship, or I can build a battleship, or I could build a firehouse.
Time machine.
I could do whatever I wanted with these Legos. And there's a lot of them. And they're really cool Legos. It's not just the shitty orange and yellow blocks. It's like the cool, you know, astronaut ones or the medieval ones and stuff like that. So that's what I mean when I say potential. I see a lot of guys out there that if you put the right sparkle on them, there's a level of talent in Northern California where if it was presented properly, I think a lot of these guys are ready to be superstars.
Okay, now, and Ugly Green.
Green just means somebody new, somebody inexperienced, but it's not necessarily a bad thing. I mean, it's good to have a new flock of people to draw from. The problem you face is that every promoter's trying to reinvent the fucking wheel. And they're trying to find that new guy or that new star. Problem is, some of those guys ain't ready. You know, so you have guys everybody hates Vinny Massaro. The fucking guy worked his ass off. His psychology's fucking really good. He's a prick to work with. He's a fucking. And the wrestling business is a horrible human being. He's a fucking great person outside. I love that dude. But he's hard to book because Vinny, if he doesn't want to show up, he won't show up. But Vinny knows a lot about the fucking business. He's a great trainer. Now you have a lot of people who are training people, and they never fucking finish their training.
So you get these guys, not only are they not, they're new in the business, they're not fucking properly trained. It's like now if you go on monstersring.com or iSpots and buy a fucking ring, now you can be a trainer because you watch the videos on YouTube of fucking Secrets of Wrestling or whatever. You know, so now everybody thinks they can fucking train people because they had a couple matches. But you don't have the quality people training people anymore. Most times because those guys just, they're frustrated with the business.
Yeah.
You know, you get a couple quality trainers around here, there's some good trainers here. But then you always have those guys who you train by? By this guy. Who? He's been in NorCal for how long? You know, and but they're working shows because the promoter wants to find the new guy or they want to find somebody who's going to work cheap.
Yeah.
And they'll tell a kid, hey, dude, stick with me, buddy. I'll get you in fucking a cage match on YouTube or something. Or what's the famous one, Shane? We got TV in the works. Yeah. We got a TV deal in the works. Yeah. Kid, you're going to be good on TV. Yeah. When for years.
2 a.m. on Channel 17, Cable X.
Well, and fucking a YouTube channel or Cable X isn't fucking TV. But in the NorCal scene, there's probably maybe six guys who are ready for TV.
Yeah.
And not saying they can't work, but working on TV is fucking 9 days.
And you're not just blowing smoke. I mean, you have that experience of working on TV in Portland and having to deal and working with Rowdy Roddy Piper and just seeing guys who aren't ready for TV on TV. And then
yeah, that was 90% of the roster.
Yeah, and, but then seeing like what it took to be television ready.
Well, when we first started going to Portland, we changed wrestling in Portland.
Uh-huh.
When Culbertson was running it, I think it was 2005 or whatever. I brought Chupi and Virgil, Thatcher, I think Shane came up a little bit. We just brought fucking the Rick Luxury was up. There was some great fucking talent came in. They ended up doing a pay-per-view, and there was only two Portland guys on the fuck, or three. Well, actually, Billy Two Eagles, but he was so drunk he didn't fucking know he was there. There was really four Portland guys. The rest were NorCal guys, and I don't even want to say, but SPW guys.
Yeah. All right, now this was something I was going to hit on later, but Ugly hit that now, because I remember you taking us up to Portland and them not being very happy with the fact that there is this crew of guys coming up from California who had better gimmicks, better ring gear, and better ring work, and better locker room etiquette. I mean, we kind of forced them to up their game. And so the topic I was going to hit later, but it's something that each of you can relate to, and I definitely want to pick your brain on this. How important is it to lead NorCal? Now you've wrestled all over the world, and how important is it for wrestlers to leave Northern California?
To me, it was very important. I felt like when I left, as Virgil said, when I left, I came back and I saw how great we really were. But just to get out and do it, and just to go somewhere, you talked about going to locker rooms, you have to bring a buddy.
Yeah.
But I think there's a lot about going to a locker room where these 30 guys know each other and you're the stranger. You need to show up and do your job. Mm-hmm. And ideally, and I'd say 90% of the time that this happens from someone from California, we go in there and make them all feel like shit because they all thought they were great. And we go out there and do a match with someone that isn't that great there. We make them look better than they've ever been. And
yeah,
we do things they've never thought of. And it's universal around Northern California. We have a pace, we have a style, we have a mentality that we bring to our work that, like I said, came from having that dark period where we were doing it in front of nobody and we're like, fuck it, we're doing it anyway for us. And around the country, a lot of other people aren't doing it for themselves. They're doing it for whatever, egotistical, or, you know, we're all in this for some ego, but they're doing it for a different reason.
Okay. Now, Virgil, you were talking a little bit about traveling. How important was it for you to be outside of Northern California doing this?
Very important. It was one of the things, it was early in my career, when you're training, and that's the thing, when you have a trainer that is on the road, that is getting you bookings, it teaches you etiquette. The reason I got my driver's license is because my trainer was taking me on the road and I need to learn how to drive. So being out of my comfort zone was very important to me as a person. You know what I mean? When you're going on the road, you're getting treated like Satan, and they won't even give you a Starbucks coffee, you know? And you have people that don't even know you that are willing to cuss people out. It teaches you camaraderie with people, and you learn something different. When your shoulder's hanging halfway out your body, and somebody's willing to drive, like, 18 hours home, you know, it teaches you something about that person. That's the difference between being comfortable. There's so many people that are in their comfort zone.
Yeah.
When you get out of things and you get into things, you really find out what people are made of, and that's the bigger difference about things, like getting out.
So definitely getting out of that comfort zone. Now, you've got a great relationship with Southern California and so many wrestlers. How important is it to get out of Northern California to do this?
You know, I really started my career in Southern California, even though I trained here with Paul DeMarco and Oliver Johns in 1998. I didn't even know there was wrestling companies here other than like Eddie Monte and T.C. Martin, and they didn't really run a lot, mm-hmm. and they weren't going to put me on shows. Mm-hmm. I called Rick Bashman, and that's how I got really booked in L.A. Not that that's anything to be proud of, because he's a douchebag. He made Roland look like a saint, honestly. Mm-hmm. But really, I spent most of my early part of my career wrestling in like Arizona and Vegas and SoCal, and I would drive there. I'd get off work on Thursdays, and I'd go down for three or four days, mm-hmm. and I just worked awful LA shows just for experience, because I really didn't know there was even any companies up here running until I think I ran into some shitty promoter that I want to mention.
Okay.
So I think we all know who I'm talking about.
Three of them come to mind, so I'm sure it's one of them.
Probably, yeah, one of the three. And you know, and in my early days, I was at the same time, if something wasn't going on, I flew myself to like Boston, and I flew myself to Florida, and I flew myself to the states you didn't have to have licenses in. Mm-hmm. And in the early days of the internet, I like looked up all that stuff. Where could I go and just show up?
Yeah.
And that's what I did, and I was able to do that and get a lot of experience and wrestle guys that I still don't even know their names. I just know they were like, hey, this kid's from California and you're gonna wrestle him.
Yeah.
You know, I got my ass kicked for 3 or 4 or 5 years in a row, and I don't think I always joke, I don't think I ever won a match until like 2003. Okay. So, I mean, but getting out, just getting out of where you're from is the best thing. You know, I know like Riv and Brittany will tell you, the first thing I tell them, or even like Levi Shapiro, I train. First thing you do is pay me, get your training, get a passport, and then fucking leave.
Yeah.
Simple.
And Shapiro's wrestling in Texas, is it, or is it in Arizona?
Texas.
Yeah,
okay.
It's Texas.
Yeah.
Texas.
Now the reason why I have experienced wrestling out of Northern California is because of you, and you took us kicking and screaming, saying, "No, you're coming up here. You're doing this." Why was that so important to take your students out of their comfort zone?
Well, two reasons. One, because I didn't want my guys' first match to be on my show, because if they were shit, I didn't want my product to look like shit. Mm-hmm. So I had them wrestle in Portland.
There you go. I appreciate it.
But no, it basically serves two purposes. As a trainer, you don't just train how to handle yourself in the ring. You teach your students everything about the business. Mm-hmm. And going on the road and knowing how to handle yourself on the road, knowing how to handle yourself in the locker room, knowing how to handle yourself when somebody tries to tune you up, and networking is one of your jobs as a trainer. And if I can get my students booking in places, why not? I mean, mm-hmm. that's my business card. So now when I go up there, you know, once a month to wrestle, and they still talk about my students. They follow them on YouTube and all over. And they work some shows together sometimes, and they know each other. And it's weird because when I did my spinoff company or my charity company, we ran a show here at the Teen Center, and I used guys from up there, from down here.
Yeah.
And it was just like cross matches that nobody's ever seen before. That never happened before. Mm-hmm. I think me and fucking Dante were the only match that ever fucking had happened before.
Yeah.
But you know, you had a Virgil Russell Cobb, which I don't think had ever happened before, and fucking like CJ Edwards wrestling Chute. And
yeah.
They're just like big guys from down there wrestling our main guys from down here. And it was just a good for all these guys to mix. And then, you know, what's the thing they do? They go on Facebook and add each other on, and now they're buddy-buddy, yeah, and they try to get bookings with each other.
And oddly enough, the last time my band played in Portland, half of the audience was the pro wrestling community. So it was awesome. There's these huge guys at the show.
You know, wrestling, you try to extend your family and, like, virtually in your comfort zone. So these guys know now when they go to Portland, mm-hmm. if they ever go up there and I'm not around, they feel comfortable because the Blanchards are up there, because Sullivan's up. All those guys are there. It's a big family now. The family grows, you know. We're trying to actually get Hood Slam up there before. I said we, but they're trying to get Hood Slam to go up there before because I think it's a great market for Hood Slam up there. But you just start networking, and then you become, like, family. You help each other out. If they're booking somewhere, you run across each other's paths all time.
Yeah.
You know, so I try to help my students out, and then in turn, when my kids are in the business, mm-hmm. they fucking help my kids out because I was good.
Yeah.
At them, you know, so.
Yeah. And Shane, you traveled all over with ISW and all over the world. and that you were still in that comfort zone, but if you had experience being in a locker room outside of your comfort zone, outside of NorCal, why do you think that's important?
I think it gives you perspective. I think it really, it's like Sheik said, it's once you step outside of, because there's this historical thing where Northern California for the most part has always been what's considered an island. All of the media, all the attention is on the East Coast, and Deep South, and it's changed a lot, especially with like PWG down in SoCal has opened up a lot of people have eyes on California. But Northern California is very different. Indie wrestling in Northern California is very different from Southern California wrestling. They think we're stiff. The guys down in SoCal think that we hit a little hard, and that we're a little wild and a little crazy, and I think that you don't see that when you work in Northern California. You just think, well, this is how we work. This is how we put on shows. And then you go outside of Northern California, and first of all, you realize, oh, they think we're mean. They think we hit people hard, and that we're kind of pricks about it. But also beyond that is more important than that, I think, is the psychology outside of Northern California. I think once you get outside of Northern California, you have a lot of guys that are just going through the motions, telling the same stories that have been told in pro wrestling over and over again. And here, we have a lot of cats thinking outside the box that are trying to do stuff that's not the same old thing, that are trying to get off the hamster wheel and do some kind of completely different motion that isn't the same old. And when you go outside of our comfort zone and you realize, well, people are just doing the same thing they've been doing for 20, 30 years.
Yeah.
And hey, it worked last time, let's do it again. And then you come back here and you realize, well, everybody in Northern California, you know, one thing I can honestly say, and this goes back to something that everybody else has mentioned, everybody here works their ass off.
Yeah.
And everybody here does the best they can do with what they're given to do. And they're not just, it's like Samurai said, they're not just happy with the status quo. Yeah, we did really good, but we're going to do better next month.
Yeah.
That match was awesome, but we're gonna top it next show.
Yeah.
So that's a mentality that is not universal in indie wrestling. There's much more of a, let's keep doing it.
Good worked enough.
Last time, let's just keep treading water. But here, you see a lot of guys that are trying really, really hard to break new ground. And I think you have to get outside that bubble before you can recognize that.
Now, and Samurai, I'm going to have you lead off this next section, which is related to that when we're talking about comparing NorCal to scenes outside of NorCal. Hit you guys with these two questions. What does NorCal have that other scenes don't? And what does NorCal lack that other scenes have? So if you guys can give me those two questions. So from what your experience has been outside of NorCal, what does NorCal have that they lack, and what are we lacking that they have?
I'm going to do the second one first because that's easy.
Yeah.
I've always felt the thing that NorCal's lacking the most is spotlight. Like even in the darkest age that Sheik was talking about, there was always some gems that were better than the guys that were in PWI Illustrated. And I always felt that if Adam could get a look, or Timmy could get a look, or Virgil, Chupi, Sheik, and so many others, that they wouldn't be here anymore. And you look around, just people in this room who are staring at me right now because I'm holding a microphone, there's many people in here that if they were in Florida, they would be in all the magazines, because they would be on all the trendy shows, the well-known shows, and they would be, you know, Philly and all that circuit. And I've always thought if we could just get a little spotlight, and we're starting to get it because NXT is slowly filling up with NorCal guys.
Yeah.
You know, which is awesome. Not that the WWE is the end-all be-all goal for or has to be the goal, but I firmly believe that if you're on a show, you should want to be the best guy on the show. And that doesn't mean you should want everyone else on the show to be crap. You should just want to be a measuring stick instead of a opening match guy. And as we see more people get spotlight, I think it's finally changing. You know, Timothy Thatcher's now getting flown all over the country, and he's getting flown. Companies are calling him and saying, we need you in Florida for 3 days. And, well, I can't, I'm in New York that weekend. You know, so I think that's the start of NorCal people finally getting the spotlight they deserve.
What do we have that
seems to have? I can't say. I've done SoCal, I've done Oregon, and I had one very memorable weekend with Frost in Arkansas that he's still very bitter about. So I can't really say what they lack, but what we have that I would put against any other territory is pride, and not like the bad type of pride, but true pride. Even if she hated me, say she hated my guts, if he were and I were booked on a show, we would have no doubt that our goal would be to steal that show. Right? It wouldn't be, I'm going to fucking break Samurai's nose because 5 years ago he gave me a little weird look at Denny's or whatever. We don't even have to be friends, because it's still, if I'm on a card, I want to make sure the fans leave going, fucking Samurai's pretty good for an old ugly fuck. He, you know, he delivers, in whether it's comedy, hardcore, in a schoolgirl outfit because Ugly was mean to me and made me dress as a woman. You know, it's, and other territories may have that. But I would argue that no one has it more than we have it. I mean, I've seen Virgil in the locker room, and I've talked to Shane for 3 hours at APW as we've broken down every aspect of every match. Because you can tell by looking which guys take it seriously and want the spotlight, and which guys are just kind of content just being on the card.
And DiRico, what do we lack that other areas may have, and what do we have that others don't?
In the realm of wrestlers, we lack women talent. We have phenomenal wrestlers here, like Brittany, and Savoy, who's coming up, and Mandy Rose, who are busting their asses and getting the job done, but Savannah Riley, who's coming up as well.
But definitely Southern California.
Yeah, there's only like six.
I think you named
every single
one. And then you cross the grapevine and you have, there's 90
shows, a show comprised entirely of.
The only problem is that their best talent, so I'm just going to go with LA because that's where I was recently, with the exceptions of Christina, who lives Bon Erie, who lives back east, and Candace LeRae. Most of those girls can't carry our girls' jocks. So it's like, it's the
you give and take. Jocks?
Yeah, I don't know. Bra straps? I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, it's so it's kind of that, we have these really, really good female wrestlers, but there's five or six of them.
There's only so many times you can see them wrestle each other over.
Exactly, and there's, like I said, there's, it seems like somebody's girlfriend is a wrestler down in LA every single show.
Yeah.
But, you know, for example, Brittany Wonder, I'm not going to put the person down, she wrestled down last in LA, but that girl's best match ever in 3 or 4 years she's ever wrestling was Brittany carrying her for 25 minutes.
Okay. Now, that's what we lack. What do we have that they don't?
They definitely don't have our drive or desire. To go back to LA, Mikey O'Shea put it best a couple years ago. I don't know, he got some gimmick award, the MVP award for Battleground, and he goes, this belongs to NorCal, not me. And his meaning behind it was Battleground changed from kind of a shitty promotion to then bringing all these NorCal people down, and their guys went from Roadhouse to then bringing in Rico Dynamite and Tito Escondido and Sasha Derevko, who came in and really weren't known outside of Lucha Libre and maybe like Santino Brothers. They weren't getting used at all. And till this day, like their guys, when they call me and they beg me for bookings, it's, but I want to work Virgil, or I want to work Sheik, I want to work Ugly, you know, you name them. They never say, put me in an angle with a guy from LA, because they know they're going to get their best matches out of the NorCal guys.
Yeah, nice.
And, so, you know, and it's, to me, it's, honestly, LA's pretty fucking lazy. Like, really, you can go watch 10 LA shows, and you'll see the 10 same matches if the guys are on. At least here, you can have this entire roster of people do 10 shows, and you'll never see the same match. And that's the one thing that we have, and I've seen it in Vegas, and I've seen it in Portland. You know, the NorCal guys really change. Like Ugly said it, they change the game wherever they go. You know, you look at like the Scum down in Arizona and Vegas. fucking, you know, Adam's a rock star, and that's what they really are down there. Mm-hmm. You know, they're on planes and they're doing all this stuff. Well, if the guys there were that good, they would be getting those spots.
Yeah.
But they're not. They're spending that money to fly them from Reno to Arizona. They're, like you said, Tim's going all over the country.
Yeah. Let's zigzag with this, Ugly. What's something that we lack that you've seen outside of NorCal, and what's something we have that they don't?
What we lack, I believe, is not a knock on anybody in here, but is quality promoters. What I'm saying is, like, there's too many mark promoters who, not you, Sheik, like, they put so much emphasis on the belt. That's yeah. why nobody can work together, because their belt is more important than this belt. Well, this guy's a better wrestler than this is, or he's my friend, and or this is the Money Mark's son or whatever. What they don't realize is the belt's a fucking prop.
Yeah.
It doesn't mean you're really the best fucking guy in the company. It's not UFC. You know, you're not the real fucking champion. You're just a guy who's going to be there next month, so they're giving you the rub. You know, every company you go to in Northern California has a different fucking champion. And that doesn't make any fucking sense, because on the next show, he'll be a job guy.
Yeah.
You know, or he'll fucking come in, he's in a tag team one show, and the next show he's wrestling his tag partner for a fucking heavyweight title in a cage match down the street. I team with Mustafa here, and then we wrestle, you know, down the street over here. It's just, there's too many promoters who want to do their own thing that nobody works together, so the fans don't know how to breathe all of it in.
Yeah.
Because they're like, okay, well, this guy's the champion here, but match three there was another champ, but then the match four there was a different champ, but over there there's a guy, like, there's four belts over there, but there's never the one guy who just is the fucking guy that everybody wants to see. It a lot of the time is because, you know, that guy usually gets, if there's one person who can fit that, he's getting booked all over.
Yeah.
But then, you know what, you just don't have the fucking heavyweight title that much. When I did the assault thing, I didn't want any fucking belts in my company. I was telling the companies, bring in your fucking belt, defend it here.
Yeah.
I don't care about the belts, because they're all my friends anyway, so I know who the fucking best guys are. When I made my list down, I had the guys I was going to call, you know, yeah. And it was the best guys available. So whether this guy has the belt or this guy has the belt, promoters put so much weight on that's the guy that's going to take them to the new millennium, and then when he gets in that role, they're like, oh, fuck, he sucks. What do I do? Who's the best available veteran we can use to carry this fucking kid?
Yeah.
And then you have to bring in some veteran who really doesn't want to be there, or who's going to tune this kid up.
Yeah. Okay, so, now what do we have that others don't?
We just have the biggest fucking heart of any territory around. I mean, I have my students do fucking barbed wire barefooted thumbtack matches. Mm-hmm. And they do it because those three letters, FPW, mean that much to them. Mm-hmm. I've gone to some companies where a guy doesn't want to take a bump because it's not his home fed.
Yeah.
Or he's like, I'm not doing that. It's going to make me look stupid. You go to SPW, you go to Hood Slam's a perfect example. There's guys going, they say, hey, I want you to put this on and go out there and do this. Yeah, no problem. Because everybody just happy to be around each other. There's so much family.
Yeah, I saw quite possibly the best rendition of Papa Smurf. I'm sorry. When I saw earlier, you know, not to get sidetracked, I saw a post from a professional wrestler saying, hey, can anyone loan me a red beanie? And I didn't think anything of it.
That word, like, brown snake.
Yeah, and I'm like, whatever, red beanie. You know, maybe it's some euphemism for some pot smoking thing. I have no idea what the fuck he's talking about. Then the next day, I see the most glorious rendition of Papa Smurf I have ever seen in my life. And I was like, that was fucking amazing. So, yeah, it's definitely the creativity and the heart.
Well, part of the problem, too, is, like, you know, Cheeks, he goes and does his Hood Slam thing, and there's promoters that shit on that.
Yeah.
Because it's not traditional or whatever. When Sheik first started doing that and people were kind of shitting on, I told him, fuck them. Are you guys having fun? Do you guys know what you're doing? Are you outdrawing everybody? Yeah. Well, fuck everybody else who tells you it's wrong.
Yeah.
They're only fucking jealous. Like, yeah, I mean, when I first went to Hood Slam, I had my preconceived notions of it. I was like, oh, fuck, here we go. It's going to be, you know, somebody bumping on a Twinkie or something like that, which we've done at SPW before. Yeah. But when I went there, I was a fucking amazed that it's a fucking show. It's like,
I've said that I was definitely, I'm not ashamed to admit that I was one of the converted. You know, I had my preconceived notions of it. I don't smoke pot. I still appreciated the creative side of it and just that drive, and it was as evident there as it was in any other locker room I've been in, that creativity, that drive, that heart, and that desire to put on not just the best match, but the best show overall. So I want to make sure to hit everyone else because I got a few more questions and then we're going to close this up. Virgil, some things that you think we lack in our scene and some things that we have that others, that other scenes don't.
Lag-wise, it's kind of, I say consistent TV, like, as far as the things go, and that's kind of a, I think, a bigger problem, because, like, everything's kind of hitting on, you have guys who, because they're all indie companies, they'll have guys that are their guys that they'll put over, and people will kind of digest that, and some people kind of won't, and but there's no set standard where if you had consistent TV of some sort of bigger monologue, And we have that to some extent, but it's so crowded to a certain point that you have such a plethora of talent, it's hard to figure out who's good, who's not. But as far as things go, it's something needed. A bigger, compelling, consistent TV. I mean, you've had people give it a shot, you've had people try, you've had access to television, but I think a big TV deal, consistent for a couple of years, will really put guys on the map and get guys out of here and get guys going in the position that they need.
Do you think that's necessary with the age of the internet, though?
Yes and no, because, like, for take myself personally, this is just my personal, this is just me. I've had to learn two different ways to wrestle. I've had to learn to wrestle in front of a live crowd, which you're doing, basically, at Hood Slam. Mm-hmm. And then I've had to learn how to wrestle for TV, feeding to a hard cam, playing up for a crowd, giving announcers something to talk about. And a lot of guys don't know that. A lot of guys didn't learn. I didn't know it. I've had to relearn it. I got a chance to experience at Portland Wrestling, but it's something I've had to go retool myself to.
Yeah.
And I think that's a big part of what guys are missing, of seeing how things work on camera, what things look like on camera. When people start watching themselves and seeing themselves on TV, they're like, oh, shoot, I got to fix that. You know, and that's the difference. You don't have that here. You don't have consistent TV. You don't have guys going, oh, shoot, I was fat last month. You know what I mean? Like, you don't have that. You have guys that don't see their matches, so they think, oh, that was the best thing ever because I went out there and did it. But when you have consistent TV and you can sit there and watch it, pick it apart, it's a different kind of world. I think that's the missing proverbial piece.
And what do we have that others lack?
A lot of guys willing to give back. And you don't have the guys you have anywhere else that you have here because there's so many Shanes and there's so many CJs and there's so many Adams and there's so many guys that are willing to, I mean, don't get me wrong, these guys come across as dicks, Vinny Massaro's, you know what I mean, ugly for the most part.
He keeps getting mentioned in
it. Because these guys come off as dicks, hands down. Like, even this guy, we're doing more smart, but they're doing things to better you. You know what I mean? Like, to better you. They're not just telling you these things because, oh, they just, you know, like, I've had these guys tell me some real legit stuff, and half the guys in this room have been there, where you're feeling a certain way about a match. You're like, oh, that was Griffin Ireland. They're like, no, dude, that was drilling shit. Like, no, and we have that here because you have so many guys out there elsewhere that because of who they are or who their son is or whatever it may be, they don't get that. They don't get that guy that brings you down to earth and says, no, dude, you just fucked that up fundamentally. You know, I mean, like, no, it doesn't work that way.
Okay, Doc, something that we lack and something we have.
On the positive side, I think Northern California has some of the best wrestling fans around. I think we have some of the most dedicated people who they not only come out to the shows, they not only support us by buying tickets, but they're proud. Like they rock our shirts with pride. They you know, they scream from the mountaintops about how wonderful they think NorCal Indie Wrestling is. And that's not something you see everywhere. You see people that come out to wrestling shows and that's something they did and then they go and do something else. But out here we have fans that live and breathe for what we do. I mean, not that it's that important that, you know, they miss days of work or anything like that, but come showtime, fans in Northern California are some of the most loyal and adamant fans that I have ever experienced anywhere.
Okay, and what are we lacking?
There's too many guys in Northern California who take themselves way too fucking seriously, in all honesty.
Yeah.
This, you know, pro wrestling is, especially on our level, is first and foremost, it's a hobby thing. You know, it's something where, like, yeah, it would be great if we got TV, it would be great if everybody got together and put together some kind of organized territory and circuit that, you know, every booking made sense and the guy was a face here was always a face everywhere else and went, but that's kind of a pipe dream. That's probably not going to happen anytime soon until there's a large amount of money placed on the table. In the meantime, we all got to keep in mind that what we're actually doing and step outside the bubble of our little community, because we do live in a bubble in our community. And because we exist in that bubble, sometimes it's easy to forget what we're doing and what we are. Mm-hmm. And we are performers. We are people who go out there and put on a performance to entertain people. Yes, we're athletes. Yes, we're stunt performers. We're actors. We're comedians. We're clowns. But we're just entertainers, ultimately. Unfortunately, I've seen a lot of cases where people start buying into their gimmick a little bit. And I've been guilty of that myself on several occasions, and that's a big mistake, because the fact of the matter is we all got into this business because we loved it, and because at some level or another it was fun for us.
Yeah.
And if we lose that and we're not thinking about how much enjoyment, how much pleasure we're getting out of performing for our audience, then everything else is kind of pointless. Because pro wrestling is first and foremost about having a good time and putting on an amazing show. And if you start getting angry and bitter and yelly and just really overly serious about the whole thing, then it takes the fun out, and then you really have nothing.
Okay, and finally, Sheik, what are we lacking and what do we have?
I'll try and kind of just, because a lot of people covered everything, but quick example, we don't have enough female wrestlers. The female wrestlers will wrestle the men. They don't care. They're just like, all right, let's get in there, let's get physical. And what we don't have, we make up for with our spirit and our way of just kind of overcoming whatever sad or hardship we have. But at the same time, and I'll sound hypocritical in this, we don't have enough confidence in ourselves. We're sitting here saying it's impossible for us to get together and have one champion. We're all fucking sitting here. We could try. We say TV would be nice, but that's a pipe dream. Why not? Let's get TV. We've done every fucking else in California. Let's get TV. Let's have maybe not one company, but we could unify some, coordinate. We could stop bringing in people that, God, I'm not going to shit on all of them, but there's a lot of guys from the East Coast that are really great wrestlers, but we don't need to bring them in to make our show better. We got Virgil, who'll do any fucking high-flying move that anyone on the East Coast is going to do. And we don't need a Sheik from Arizona who's Italian when you've got... But like, we don't need to do that. We've got everything right here. The one thing we're also missing, there's some money marks, but it's like Alpha Omega Wrestling. I would do this place in LA and they would pay me so much money. It was so far away. They'd have 7 people in attendance. But they'd also have the Young Bucks, Joey Ryan, myself getting paid a lot, the Twins getting paid a lot, Mike Rain getting paid a lot, and then another 30 people on the show, and there's like 10 people in the audience. It's because they have a money mark. Why is it that we can do shows here for 10 years and I can draw whatever the fuck I'm getting and you can have a deal with LA and you could be Oregon and California and all around, but we can't have a money mark put money in us, but this nobody company in LA can find money like that with nothing behind it? So I think it's a lack of confidence. I think that, well,
and I think that kind of goes in line of we need that spotlight. We haven't had that spotlight. Why would someone want to invest in something that they don't know about?
They don't know about us, and we're waiting for them to find out.
Yeah.
When what I think, we went to Florida, we went wherever, and we saw, fuck man, why are we going to Florida? Let's make California tight. Because everything you would want to do is here. Instead of us trying to fit into their holes,
yeah,
let's give them what we're doing. Let's show it to them. And I think that's why I started doing what I'm doing, and that's what I think a lot of people are starting to do, and we're starting to turn over that leaf. Where it's like, we don't need to bring in the Honky Tonk Man and Brutus Beefcake and Greg Valentine to make our show sell tickets. Nobody knows who they are, and we don't need to, sorry Vendetta, we don't need to like get married to NWA. That's not what's going to make California on the map. It's going to be something new. It's going to be something organic from the heart, and we can jump over any mountain and not even realize we're doing it. But when you try and put like a real task in front of us, something tangible that we can see and we know of, like, oh, that's really hard.
Well, and I think, and quite honestly, the success that you've experienced with Hoodslam, that definitely wasn't overnight. I mean, your first few shows, it took time.
Yeah.
It took a lot of time, and I think it was that heart and that drive that we all talked about that everyone had, and you were offering something, and now it's become so successful.
At the first few 3 years, I didn't make a dime. I was just losing money. Even mm-hmm. the last three shows, hey, I didn't really make any money. Mm-hmm. But August 1st, I hopefully will. Anyway, that's not the point. The point being that, yeah, I don't know.
All right, well, what are we doing on time?
I want to be respectful to everyone.
You guys know what I'm trying to say. Fuck those.
What do we?
One more. Edlo brought New Japan Pro Wrestling.
Yeah.
Photographers from Japan, from Pro Wrestling Illustrated, came to Sacramento, Woodland, to some fair. Where? Never even heard of it.
Yeah.
Gave him a grid, whatever, to take pictures of us wrestling. Because he made that, whatever he did, I never asked him, but like I said, 10 years ago, I said that's impossible. It's happening today. We don't see it as impossible, but you put TV in front of us, oh, that's hard. He got people from Japan to look at us in magazines.
Yeah.
And we can't get on TV in California? That sounds ridiculous to me.
Yeah. I mean, and it's kind of sad when I talked about what my first experience was being in a TV studio with an audience that was about this size. And it was to promote shows at the Memorial Auditorium, shows at the Cow Palace, at the Stockton Civic Center, and so forth. All right, well, we're gonna wrap it up with one final question. And we've talked about all the positive things in our scene, and then we've also talked about the negative things, the things that we shouldn't be so proud of and that we need to work on. If someone asked me this question, I would have answered the following way. I would have said, I do whatever I can to put a microphone in my hand and to bring people together. And the question is, if there is something that you think is broken in the Northern California scene, what are you going to do to fix it? And so, to me, I agree with pretty much everything that everyone said tonight, of all the positive things, when we're talking about the heart, the drive, the desire, it's never good enough. But that, you know, that there is a lot of stubbornness. And so when someone asks me, what are you going to do to fix it? Well, I'm going to be a ham and do a talk show and make myself sit in the center where I'm the center of attention and draw everyone towards me. But the main thing is I'm going to get people to get together and talk and start discussion. Going back to that question, what do you hope to accomplish with this? I said discussion. So I'm gonna throw the question back to you guys. What if we do this in 2 years? We do this again. We won't invite Bobby. But I'll definitely take a suggestion if you have someone else to sit in there. No, but if we have
Vinny Massaro.
Vinny Massaro.
He wouldn't show up.
I'm not coming.
It's kind of funny because I got a whole stack of questions that, you know, for the sake of time, and what's one of the most negative aspects that you could have in a locker room? And I was just like, well, there's an opening for every time they mention Vinny Massaro. But no. So the question that I want to close us off with, and then I'm going to have you guys plug your upcoming appearances. There's something that needs to be fixed in Northern California. Not what should be done. What are you going to do about it? What are you going to do about it? So my answer for myself was, I'm going to do what I can to bring people together and put people in a room that normally wouldn't be coming together on a Tuesday night and Oak Park, Sacramento. Jarevko, what are you going to do?
I think we're just going to keep doing what we're doing. Trying to put a product out there that the fans enjoy, that to me is more important than the wrestlers on the show enjoy. Mm-hmm. And doing it the best I can. I have a great team of people kind of working with me right now, and honestly, it's the best team I've ever worked with behind the scenes. It's kind of like, I can't do this because I don't know how. They help me do it, and for me, that's the best way, I think, to help improve things or make things get noticed better, is by changing maybe the way I do things from the past to the way we're doing them now.
And with Action Coast Empire, you're really hitting that other facet with like producing a television show and working that out.
Working on it, yeah. And it's, you know, like putting it on the Access. You know, I know it's not TV, but
it's a step.
It's a step for us. It's a way for us to get noticed.
Yeah.
And if we can then take that edited product to people after we've taped 8 episodes and say, look, this is what we're doing.
Yeah.
It's our best way, and we have those inroads going right now. Okay. You know, so, and for us, Even moving the shows to 4 o'clock in the afternoon was to avoid basically double booking, not just with other wrestling promoters, because as we, those of us that live here know that everything in Sacramento starts at 7 o'clock. The Kings, the River Cats, the stupid soccer team,
panel discussions,
unless Bobby Hart's here, and that was just my thing. I was like, I guess that was sort of my way of being like, okay, we're not going to have any more issues, because now if that show ends at 6:15 and your show starts at 7:30 and you've got Samurai on it, he can make that show.
Okay. Now, Virgil, originally, and I'm glad, I'm actually glad that you're filling in, because originally the panel was guys who fit that, the wrestler slash booker slash promoter. But as a wrestler, what are you going to do to help fix things in Northern California?
Actually, be more or less of a wrestler.
Explain.
I need to do more business. I've had a theory for years, like I have to live it myself. It's a business in the front, party in the back. It's the mother theory. I've spent so long having fun wrestling, I never looked at the business aspect of professional wrestling. And just this last year alone, I've learned more about the business of wrestling than I've ever learned in my last 10 years of wrestling. And it showed me so much more, and I've learned so much more because of that. And that's the one thing I myself have told myself. As a wrestler, I'm fine. Like, I know it's hard to say that, and it sounds self-conscious, but as a wrestler, I think I'm fine. I think the thing I've been lacking, and you kind of hit on this, is the self-confidence factor, the business factor, and not only me learning it, but also passing it down the other. I've been in this business 10 years. I started my first shirt this year. You know what I mean? There's shirts like that you don't
exactly. Exactly. And that was the, and you know, that's the thing that I always try to bring in from the punk rock side of wrestling. Is like, I never made money in punk rock. I never make my money off the venue or the promoter. We make it off of merchandise.
And that's part of the business. And I think I spent so long not only just being a wrestler but teaching wrestling. I didn't teach the business and give guys that back. Yeah. Also, now that I'm learning, I'm trying to teach other guys that. So from what other guys do, the same thing I'm doing, because I spent so long not doing those things, not marketing myself as a businessman. And that's where I think I lack a lot. And as the year progresses, I hope to do more of that.
Okay. And Sheik, what are you going to do to fix things?
I mean, like, specifically, I feel like more things like buying advertising time at the beginning of Botchamania, continuing to put things on Smart Mark video, even if they don't sell great, you know, every time it's printed, someone on the East Coast sees our name again. Yeah. Every time they see Hood Slam, they see Northern California. Continuing this, you know, if we can get on TV, great, I'd love to do that. I'm going to try and stay sane, because this is my life. I don't, you know, have kids, wife. I'm amazed by the Chupacabras and the Virgils and everyone with wife and children who's able to wrestle too, because I can't do that. I'm going to try and stay sane, and, you know, without the job, without the wife, you know, no strings. I'm going to try and fly, because I need to have confidence, and no one who's ever levitated, how do I say this? A lot of people say, I don't believe in flying. I'm going to be like R. Kelly. I believe I can fly. You say I can't fly, you're never going to leave the ground. I think I might one day. And you might not believe me, but I know you'll never leave the ground with that attitude. I think it might be possible for me, for us, and that's my goal, fly or die.
Hey, and Samurai, what are you going to do? What are you going to do to fix things?
Oh, now it works. Should I lay on the ground?
There you go. Now you can go.
You did that on purpose.
I did.
I'm nothing special. I'm just a waiter at Applebee's. So what I've tried to do, and Virgil alluded to it, is I've tried to let people who are good at things do their things and have stepped up. And the thing that the only positive I'm doing, besides providing the third Sunday of every month a chance for people who want to wrestle. So Lord knows I don't pay, because I don't make any fucking money. So there's no money in it. But we open the doors, and the people who want to work get to work. But I think what we've changed lately that I see is a long-term benefit is the camps are no longer like SPW camps in the SPW way. Big Ugly came in and ran the camp this Sunday. The two previous ones were Reno Scum. Yeah. Basically, and you know, I'm talking to Jekylls about coming in and running a camp. And on those days, we've had as many as 25 students show up from whether they're the Commando students or Dylan's students or Drake Younger's former students, and all doing things, being introduced to a different way, and they may think the way's wrong or whatever, but they end up leaving. Now they have a bond with the other young guys. So maybe the young guys coming up, because when I was coming up, there was a lot of hatred. I was just taught that APW was the enemy. Yeah. And they hated me before they even met me because I was Ugly's boy and I would agree with anything Ugly said. And I'm hoping that by having this open door where Bobby Hart's training or Ugly's training or Paul Isidore's training, that in 5 years when those people are the roster, then we will have the solutions to the problems that like Jeremko's talking about, because it'll all be one community. Instead of, that guy doesn't know what he's doing, we're the only ones who know how to wrestle. Because that was the mentality for so long.
Yeah.
That if you were SPW, oh, you only did hardcore. Which was bizarre, because I didn't get hit with a chair until like a year in training. You know, we did other things. So I just
hope... I got hit with a chair like 3 months into training.
Right, yeah, you want to be a wrestler.
It's good for business.
And then, you know, we do a camp in Yuma City on Mondays, and it's an open-door camp. Anyone who wants to come work out with us can come work out. And I think that there's no benefits short-term, but I think long-term that makes the health of NorCal down the line potentially better. Because there's way too many people who aren't doing anything to improve as wrestlers, but they're on the card, and they're like, yeah, I'm good enough. So I like seeing Jeff Cobb, J.R. Kratos, and C.J. Kearse, and Virgil Flynn sort of glaring at each other like, oh, that was pretty good, but let's see if you can do this. And the student's going, well, I want to try that. Because those are four very different minds who have been four different places. And so hopefully, you know, that leads to peace, love, and happiness in 5 years.
Okay. Now, and Doc, before I throw it over to you, one of the questions that I was going to hit on was, what's the most negative thing that a wrestler brings to the locker room? And then on the flip side, what's one of the most positive things? And I think I'd feel guilty if I didn't bring it up, that you're one of the most positive people in that locker room. And I'm sorry if that tarnishes your image. I always enjoy watching you talk to younger wrestlers with that creative passion. And to the point where, like, if you feel like they're not listening, you, like, put your hand on the shirt. It's like, I'm giving you a gift right now. You better fucking take this. And I just, there's no question here. I just think that's one of the things that I absolutely adore when I see in the locker room is the passion that you take when talking to the other members of the roster. So now that I'm done blowing smoke up your ass, what's one of the things you're going to do to try and fix things in Northern California?
Well, unlike my associate Sam right here, I am something special. So I'm going to be, just to kind of prove to you that I'm not all sunshine and sausages, mm-hmm. I'm going to be an arrogant prick right now and say I'm going to keep on doing what I've done for over 20 years now. I have changed wrestling in Northern California several times. Multiple occasions I have made an impact around here, and I'm going to keep on doing that. And the way I'm going to do that is to think outside the box, to do things that nobody else is thinking of doing or is willing to do. I'm going to kick down walls. I'm going to force people to look at what we do in a completely different light than what they have in the past. Because at this juncture, I think most people, and I'm not talking about the people that are here because they're the converted. This is the choir of our church. Yeah. You know, these people, they don't need to be brought into the fold. They're already part of the family. But people outside who have preconceived notions of what we do are only getting a, you know, 1% view of what pro wrestling is. And I'm going to show them the rest of it, and I'm going to show them stuff that they didn't even know was there, stuff that we didn't even know was there. Awesome. So I'm just going to keep doing what I do.
Awesome. And Ugly, what are you going to do to fix things?
I'm going to get out the fucking way of the new guys coming in. I mean, at this point in my career, you know, Vince ain't sending me that call, Aaron ain't calling me, Japan, Mexico aren't calling me. My job or my position now is to get the younger guys ready. And I feel my bigger job is to teach the veterans how to be a fucking veteran. When you go to a show and a promoter says, hey, you're jobbing to this guy tonight, yeah, sure, no problem.
Yeah.
It's not, I gotta get my shit in, I'm gonna fucking tune this kid up. We're independent contractors, they hire you to do a fucking job, you go do it, no matter what it is. the marks in the front row don't know I've been wrestling 20 years and this guy's been wrestling too. You know, they're buying into the characters and the gimmick. So my job as a fucking veteran, which I hate saying that, but I am in the NorCal Wrestling Hall of Fame. But my job is to get the younger guys ready. With SBW, I'm working with the nerd guy right now. And he's a younger guy. He's got a lot of potential, big future in the business.
Yeah.
He needs some work. My job is to get him fucking ready. You know, and I've done it with a lot of people, and I'll continue to do it because that's my role. I want to lead this business better when I'm gone than it was when I'm here. So once I back away, I want to be able to go sit in the show and say, yeah, it was time for me to leave. Not like, fuck, I can make this kid look good. Who the fuck is this piece of shit?
Yeah.
You know, like I do at a lot of shows now.
But that's going to be a difficult position for you because you can't really step aside because you're still one of the biggest draws. You're still one of the biggest names, and you're still one of the best workers who could teach someone in that ring. So it's
I'm not saying I'm quitting next week.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is, like, at some point you have to back away a little bit. Mm-hmm. You still stay in the fold because 9 times out of 10, people that start this business 3 or 4 years, they're gone anyways.
Yeah.
Because WWE didn't call them. They don't have the fucking heart and the passion.
Yeah.
I'm going to be in here whether I'm working, whether I'm training people, whether I'm just doing commentary.
Yeah.
But whether I'm just backstage helping people out, I love the business. I love the guys I'm with. And I love the business so much, I don't want to be the fucking old guy with the cowbell walking around tuning up a green one. You know, I think the business doesn't need certain people in it, or you need to be in another aspect of the business. I love
how that just came full circle. You couldn't have written a better story. I get
Facebook messages all the time from Brittany, from Mandy, asking me, hey, can you watch this match for me?
Yeah.
People from Morgantown, can you watch this? And I really value that, you know, because those are my students, but I really value people asking my opinion on things. Whether they take it or not, just blowing smoke in my ass is one thing, but I still get people to this day asking me, hey, how did you think this went, or how could I do this better? Mm-hmm. And I ask them the same thing. You know, Samurai, we talk, you know, all the time about different ways to do things and stuff. And
yeah.
I value what we have in our community so much, and it gives me a lot of pride to see where, like, Sheik's gone with Hood Slam, to see what Virgil's doing. I'll tell you right now, Virgil's going to have some big shit going on pretty soon. To see what Samurai's done with SPW, to see what Derefko's doing with Battleground, one of the few guys who hired me still. I'm happy to see that this motherfucker, out of all the shit we've been through together, is still doing the same fucking shows with me. We've been through a lot of shit together, me and this knucklehead. And it just really warms my heart that guys who were taught to shit on us, or shit on me mainly, are now like, dude, I don't know what the fuck they were talking about, you're fucking awesome.
Yeah.
You know, most of the guys in NorCal, the big circle, I either trained them or gave them their first break in the business.
Yeah.
And to this day, they show me that respect, and that's something that I value, and I value so much that when it's time for me to get the fuck out of the way to get the nerd kid ready, or, you know, fucking Jekyll's ready, whoever, that's what my job is, because that's what you do when you have a passion for the business, not for yourself. When you value what you do in the business, you gotta understand that whether you're here or not, fucking wrestling's gonna go on. So you can either choose to make it better or be a fucking bitch and try to bring everybody else down so you're the one to see if I was still there, they'd be drawing fucking the building out. Yeah. No, you make it better so you can just be a mark in the audience. Oh shit, I'll buy that t-shirt. I'll be the first fucking guy with it. I wear my Virgil Flint shirt all the time.
Yeah.
You know, I have an Honor Society shirt. I have my fucking Sheik little fucking magnet on my refrigerator. So that's what Sheik said. I'm a fucking mark for my friends because I was there when nobody was booking them. And they were just driving carloads to come down and wrestle for SPW.
Yeah.
The twins were coming in here fucking, you know.
On Wednesday nights.
Yeah.
When we were doing the student show. Yeah, from Pogo's bringing
those guys in. And I mean, we've been through it all together. So to see those guys in the position I was 10 years ago, it makes me really happy that they're still struggling. They're still fighting the fight. And when it's my time to leave, it's my fucking time to leave. Because I know when I walk in that locker room, everybody's going to stand up and shake my hand and say, thank you, boss.
Yeah.
Because I've earned that respect, and they get that respect from me.
And rightfully so. Well, I want to thank you guys for making adjustments to your schedule due to my bowels. And
not the first time.
I know, I'm telling you. And it really is ironic that we're having this discussion in a room that was sometimes our dressing room.
Yeah.
I mean, I remember seeing Tonga Kid go through a bag of Doritos sitting right over there, faster than anyone else.
Tonga Kid is a whole other discussion.
There you go. We'll save that for another one. I really appreciate this. We all hit on the word passion and heart, and those are the things that I think drew me into the Northern California wrestling scene and have kept me here.
Even if I'm not active in the ring anymore, it still keeps me in touch with what you guys are doing. And quite frankly, as a 23-year veteran of the Sacramento punk music scene, the local music scene can learn a hell of a lot from the guys sitting up here, the men and women sitting out there, everyone running shows and promoting and all that. And I just really think that you guys are an inspiration, and I'm hoping that today started off some discussion in a sport and an art that I can't even put into words how much I love and respect. So before we go, why don't you guys plug what you got coming up next? So, Dereko, what do you got coming up?
August 30th at the Collins Teen Center. Doors open at 3:30. The first bell's at 4.
That's it. In West Sacramento?
On the other side of the bridge. It's Big Ugly's hometown. We got Tyler Bateman versus Sasha Derev because we're main event. And I'm drawing a blank on all the other matches.
Get there early.
Yeah, get there early. Cause trust me,
it gets packed. Virgil, what do you got coming up?
I'm a wrestling whore. I got a bunch of stuff coming up. I got Fit Slam Friday. I think I have Revolution Sunday. I got a bunch of things going up. SPW every third Sunday of the month till guys drop dead. And then.
Glad you didn't specifically look at me when you said that.
Rip Slam every first Friday till guys drop dead. And that's about like really it for me.
Before I forget, here's Bobby's drink tickets.
Hasn't someone actually died there?
They always come back.
Yeah, they always come back.
There's become zombies, so I guess.
Yeah. All right, Chief. So, Chief, this Friday in the Oakland Metro, you've got Hood Slam. Anything else coming up?
August 23rd will be our first show in San Francisco.
Okay.
That's all I wrestle for now. Okay. All right. And I support SPW coming in.
Okay. And then, and Samurai, what do you got coming up?
SPW on the third Sunday, and then do Al Core, Virgil. I have 9 shows in August just because I want to see. Basically, I've forgotten how to say no. Hey, Samurai, do you want? Yeah.
Okay.
So
keeping busy.
Watch my social media. I have no life, so all I talk about is wrestling. So
all right, the mayor of Hood Slam, soon to be the mayor of San Francisco. What do you got coming up, Doc?
I'm the mayor of the whole fucking universe. Hood Slam first Friday, this Friday. Hood Slam. Come out. Best goddamn show in the world right now. And we will be invading San Francisco later on in August, the first of what I'm sure will be many, many trips across the Bay Bridge for us. As soon as summer's over, old Sparky Ballard will be start running Gold Rush down in Pacifica again, and Doc Atrocity is always a regular attraction there. Other than that, you know, a bob and a weave show up where I want.
Yeah, you never know when Doc's going to come
never
here.
Know.
All right. Ugly, what do you have coming up?
I'm going to go home and Facebook a lot about tonight.
All right.
Instagram. Not really. I mean, I have SPW coming up. I'm back at DOA in Portland the 22nd or 23rd, 24th. Mm-hmm. Other than that, just, you know, live my dream. Trying to finish school and keep up with these fucking knuckleheads here. I don't do much wrestling anymore.
Gentlemen, thank you once again. This is our first time trying this. I feel really confident with what we did, and I'm really happy that you guys were here. Thank you for filling in, Virgil. I really appreciate that. Thank you to everyone who came out. I appreciate you guys changing your schedules. I know we were scheduled for this back a while ago, but I appreciate you guys coming out on a Tuesday. Thanks for coming and supporting Cafe Colonial. It's a DIY, do-it-yourself punk rock venue. They do music shows here, and when I presented them with this idea of what I wanted to do, they were extremely open. So please make sure to thank the staff here for letting us do this. Come on out here for shows, and please always, if you've got flyers for one of your shows, please feel free to bring them by and leave them here, because it's always been my mission to get more punk rockers to come out to wrestling shows. Okay, because God knows I've seen so many of you guys at my fucking shows, so we need to fucking, you know, pay you back for that. So thank you very much, everyone. I hope you enjoyed yourself, and God bless each and every one of you.